Welcome, Sue. Glad to see you on. If you would just tell everybody where you're from in the chat area, and we're gonna formally start it here as soon as it reaches 1 o'clock. Welcome, Sue Guise. It's nice to have you. We're going to get started just in a 1 minute or two. I think I'll give people another minute to log on, and we'll have a brief introduction of the technology. I think most of you have done this before. Well, I'm not sure how many people will join us for the day, but maybe this is it. And then because this is a big presentation, we're going to get started. I want to thank all of you for logging on. And I also want to explain that this we're experimenting all the time with this. And I am out in a hotel room in Western Michigan right now at the Great Lakes Fruit Worker Conference. And Greg Loeb is in Geneva. And you guys are all over the place, so this is one of the advantages of being able to use this technology. I do want to show everybody, make sure they're aware of how to get around this a little bit. Here's the agenda. We're going to stay as close to this as possible. You can actually drag it down and see that we will be ending by 2, though. And this is your chat area. This bar here is where you type in, and then you hit the Have any problems with the chat? You can give me some icons or something right down here in the lower left hand, and there will be a flag or something that will happen to show me that you're having some challenges, and then maybe I can address that. All right. We are recording this session, and along with the other ones, in case you've missed them, we do have them on the webcast page that all of you have the URL to. The other thing that we did differently this time is we sent a handout in advance, and then we also have it posted here in this file sharing. And I believe that you would be able to download it right from this presentation. So even as a recording, you can get the handout. That's pretty much it. And I think at this point we're going to move into the classroom area. It doesn't appear to be that anybody else is joining us. So let's go in here and I'll introduce Dr. Greg Loeb. He is an entomologist with Cornell University, specializing in fruit crops, and he works out of the New York State Ag Experiment Station in Geneva, New York. And he is going to help us as extension agents better understand and manage some important insect pests of berry crops. And Greg, if you want to take it from here.
Sounds good. Thanks, Laura. A beautiful day outside. In some ways, it's too bad we're stuck in here, but hopefully it'll be worth your time and learning a little bit about some of the insect and mite pests of small fruit crops. I'm going to move through this presentation. I'll try not to go too quickly, but there's a number of insect pests I want to cover. Before I do that, though, I wanted to share with you what objective is I am trying to accomplish in this, 50-minute or so presentation. These are things I thought about as I put together the slides of what I wanted to achieve. And this is also included on the handout that Laura got out to you earlier. And so one of the things, since you guys all have responsibilities for lots of different crops and topics, one of the things that might be helpful in dealings with small fruit is simply to be able to identify or recognize the major pests in strawberries, blueberries, or raspberries. So I hope I'm going to give you enough information to help you do that. It's important in developing a management strategy to have some sense of when these insects or mites are present in the various crops, at least a rudimentary sense of pest phenology. So for all the pests I'm going to talk about today, I'm going to kind of show you what that phenology is. You probably won't remember all of it, but it gives you some kind of basis to build on. For some of the pests, we have developed pretty good monitoring tools to evaluate whether you have enough of them to warrant some sort of control tactic. And so I'll talk about those when they're available. And I will also talk about some control methods. In this case, I'm not going to dwell a lot on the chemical control because that's available to you through the guidelines and some other sources. But I certainly will mention a few things, and more importantly, the proper timing or strategy behind their use. But I'm also going to talk about other control techniques. And finally, I'll remind you of some of the places you can go to get more information if you're dealing with a small fruit crop and a pest in that crop. Okay, I guess if you have problems, just send it through on the chat room and we'll proceed. This next slide is going to be review for a lot of you, I'm sure. You've had this in coursework or certainly just an experience, but I think it's worth looking at just to provide some sort of framework for assessing some of these key pests I'll talk about in a bit. At the core of an IPM program is a good understanding of biology and ecology of a pest. Like I mentioned, the phenology and life cycle is important, what natural enemies they are. You need this information to really move forward and to develop a pest management strategy, especially, in an era of chemical control when that's not the only potential tool you have to control. For some of the other control methods, you really need a lot better knowledge of the ecology of the pest. Secondly, you need a good sense of the relationship between the density of that pest and the damage or impact that they cause. And that the reason for that is that it takes a certain number of pests to reach that economic injury level, something I'm sure you've all familiar with. When possible, you hope to have a decent sampling protocol to determine really if you are close to this economic injury level and whether it's worth using some sort of control tactic. Now, I've listed here several control tactics that are useful in small fruit crops. Chemical is certainly our most common tool, but we have others. Biological control, I think, is quite important in small fruit crops, even if we don't really recognize that to be the case. Host plant resistance can be important for arthropod pests and particularly for disease pests. There's cultural practices that growers can do to reduce pest pressure, and I'll try to review some of these for each of the pests I cover. Now, what pests should we look at? If I just go through the Cornell guidelines and listed all the insect pests for blueberries, raspberries, or cane fruit and strawberries. I come up with a list like this. You know, I don't know, there's about 20 or 25 pests here, and there's certainly many more pests that I could include. And this is way more than I could cover in a 50-minute conversation with you. And really, it's probably more than you need to know much about, because you're unlikely to see these pests, all of these pests, as important economic pests. So what I try to do is, let's focus in on the two or maybe three pests in each of those three major small fruit crops that you're likely to see in visiting grower farms, or if you get phone calls about some problem. These are the ones that are likely to show up that having some base knowledge of would be helpful. You know, you might get other some of these other insects showing up, and maybe then you're going to need to refer to some of these resources, or give me a call, or send me an email to see if we can sort it out. Okay, so the ones in yellow in this slide are the pests I'm going to try to go through. We'll start with strawberry pests. I'm going to talk about three different pests. Now, Laura and I came up with some what she calls poll questions that will be presented to you as I get to the end of each of these pests, just to, I don't know, see if I've done a good job actually of explaining things. If you can answer the questions correctly, then I guess I have, and also to kind of give you something else to do besides just listen. Okay, this is the first pest I want to talk about. It's probably pretty familiar to you. The adult stage here is on the left on the strawberry fruit. Here's the immature stage on the flower. And then on the right is a damaged fruit caused by the feeding of this adult and immature, something called catface. This is probably familiar to most of you if you've worked in strawberries. This is tarnished plant bug, a true bug in the order Hemiptera. An important pest in strawberries as well as a lot of other crops. Now, this diagram I have up now is a way that I want to go over the life cycle of each of these pests I'm focused in. So on the top I'm going to have, let me see if I can get used to using this pointer. There we go. So on this top I'm going to have the kind of time during the summer, spring to fall, and then on the left side, different stages of the insect or mite. And I'm going to focus in on sort of what the pattern is and how many generations they have in the year. So for tarnished plant bug, they overwinter as adults, overwintering in hedgerows, under larger weeds, and this kind of thing. They get active as temperatures get going in the morning, in the spring, maybe above 50 degrees. They mate and actually start laying eggs. They will move into strawberries to lay eggs and to feed, and also a lot of other plant species, particularly weed species, and I'll talk about that more in a second. They go through 2 to 3 generations during the year. So you have this overwintered adults, they lay eggs that produce the nymphs, the immature stage, that become adults, and then they go through a second generation and sometimes a third generation. It depends on how much temperature there is during field season. And this is important, sort of how they overwinter and what time of the season they get going in terms of managing the pest in strawberries. Let me go forward then and just highlight some of the biological details I think are important to remember. They have 2 to 3 generations. They have a broad host range. It's interesting. It's got one of the largest host ranges of different plants that it feeds on of any insect that has been studied. I'm having trouble grabbing my pointer here, but it feeds on a lot of these host plants are weedy species, and that's important as we come on. All right, so Laura's putting up one of the first questions that you should have gotten out of that life cycle diagram that I presented to you.
I'm sorry.
Yes, this is.
Is this timing right? Is this timing
right? No, but that's okay.
I'm sorry. We'll try to do this better as we go along here. And I think that's all of you, so thank you. I'm just going to.
Well done.
Close that. That was quick.
All right, good, good. All right, so I can just move on, right, Laura?
Yeah.
Oh, perfect. All right, so it's an important pest. It caused this damage that really is quite expensive for a high-value crop like strawberries. So we need to have some method of evaluating its abundance in the field. Now here I'm thinking about primarily June-bearing strawberries, but you can also just use the sampling techniques in day-neutral strawberries. For the June-bearing strawberries, the most useful stage of the insect to monitor is the nymph stage, the immature stage. And we use a tapping technique that works quite well for this stage.
Greg, I'm sorry, I should have explained this. They can't see this, and you can just go on, and I can put it back, actually.
Okay. The little something happened to the slide here. The pan is put underneath the inflorescence, and you tap it against the pan, and the nymphs fall off in this white pan, and you can readily count them. For June-bearing strawberries, it's the nymphs that probably cause the most damage. The adults they're not very abundant and are probably not doing the major part of the damage. The nymphs, however, they feed on the young fruit, and that feeding on the young fruit and medium-aged fruit causes that cat facing that we don't want to see. So there's a pretty well worked out sampling program that uses this pan sampling, and it's summarized here in this slide. You should be starting at the beginning of flowering. And this is a pretty easy strategy, and I think it's helpful if growers do this because tarnished plant bug is variable. It is abundant in some years and not in others, and it makes sense for a grower to know whether it's worth spraying or not based on monitoring. And I think it's pretty quick to do. The protocols involve sampling three inflorescences at five locations and estimating the average number of nymphs per inflorescence. We've calculated that the economic threshold would be about a half a nymph per inflorescence. Above that, you're causing enough damage to the fruit that it's having an economic impact, costing the grower at least as much or more than a spray to control the pest. Okay, and another way to look at it that's a little quicker without keeping so that you don't have to keep track of actual counts is a presence-absence approach in which you would count the number of inflorescences that have one or more nymph out of 15, and if you get four or more, that's considered beyond the threshold and that it's worth treating. Okay, so monitoring, if you can train growers to do this, is a helpful cost-saving thing. Now, so I've talked about monitoring and the kind of impact the tarnished plant bug can have on strawberries. What are some control techniques? And one is cultural management. This is maybe the most important for June-bearing strawberries anyhow. Because tarnished plant bug can feed on so many different hosts, many of them are weeds. And if they're attracted to weeds or reproducing on weeds, these provide reservoirs for the bug to move on to strawberries. And so keeping the fields weed-free as possible is helpful in a lot of ways, of course, reducing competition with strawberries and removing a reservoir for tarnished plant bug and certainly some diseases as well. So as I'm sure you're all aware, weed management is important, although given that it's difficult to achieve in strawberries often, as I think Marvin Pritz talked about a few sessions ago. Another way that might be helpful in managing strawberries is using host plant resistance or based on the cultivar selected. Now growers may not jump on this one because they're going to make decisions about cultivar selection based on a lot of other things, in particular marketing issues. But we have found that cultivars that mature early in the season tend to escape damage from tarnished plant bug, and highly productive cultivars, things like honey oat, to some extent jewel, tend to spread the damage out on the different fruits to an extent that you don't see as much of that cat facing, so that they, in essence, tolerate the plant bug at a higher density. So there's two cultural approaches. I think weed management is probably the most important. There is biological control going on in strawberries. There's several parasitoid wasps that attack either the egg or the nymphal stage. And in fact, there is a species introduced, I don't know, about 15 years ago now, called Peristenis diganutis, that is a specialist on tarnished plant bug. You can see a nice picture here of a female piercing the abdomen of a nymph tarnished plant bug and inserting her egg. Now, this species has spread widely in New York and other areas, and it seems to be having an impact on tarnished plant bug. It is very sensitive to pesticides, though, and the more growers can use selective compounds or not spray in their fields, the better this parasitoid and many other natural enemies do. Biological control. Now, chemical control, there are several options for this, and I've just have them listed here on this slide. Like I said, I'm not going to spend a lot of a time on the chemical control options, just because I think it's pretty available for you and the grower in terms of our guidelines. But here are the ones that are listed. I typically, on the top of these lists that I'm going to give you, I'll focus on the broader spectrum materials, the ones that tend to have more negative consequences for natural enemies, but also tend to be quite effective. And on the bottom, I'll be providing maybe some organic options, like on the bottom of this list, pyrenone, which is a short-lived organic version of a pyrethroid that is effective, but because it's short-lived, you got to use it frequently. Okay, so this is what I want to talk about in terms of tarnished plant bug on strawberries. I did want to mention, though, I said that it had a lot of other hosts. Well, it, including some small fruit, other small fruit crops, it is a pest of raspberries as well as strawberries. So it's one that comes up there, although I'm not going to talk about it. But many of the principles I discussed here are relevant for raspberries. Okay, my second strawberry pest is shown here. The adult here on the left, and the immature stage that lives in the soil in the middle, and the root crown of strawberry with a hole in it, if you can see that, where a larva has caused some damage. This is the root weevil, and there's actually several species of the root weevil that can be a serious pest of strawberries. Some years it's a pest, other years it's not. Some farms have more problems with than others, but it can be a tricky one because what you often can find in severe cases is you don't see the insect, but you see that the field is in decline, its vigor is reduced, and you end up seeing a lot of extra weeds coming in. So here's a field where they've had a serious problem with root weevil, and the plants are basically dying on you, probably because there's so much damage to that crown of the plant that it can't get the nutrients and water that it needs. Okay. So strawberry, there's several species of root weevils. One most common that we deal with is the smallest one on this diagram, the strawberry root weevil. And there's two other species, a little bit larger, the rough strawberry root weevil and the black vine weevil. The black vine, you'll probably run into it. It feeds on a number of different plants, and it's a real problem in nurseries and containers. They all look about the same, except they differ in size. The life cycle of root weevils, they all have a pretty similar life cycle. The adult emerges from the soil in late May and over into June and even into early July. There's a big spread, and the species do differ a little bit. It's interesting, I make a distinction here between the adult pre-reproductive stage and the adult reproductive stage, and that's because when the adults first come out, they do not start laying eggs for a while. They need to feed for several weeks, then they start mating, and then start laying eggs. And this is important in terms of timing of control measures, and I'll come back to this. I'm trying to get this pointer working, Laura, and I just can't seem to get it.
Maybe you have to just keep it on and then drag it around, see. And you do have to keep going back to it. If you let your finger off it, I think you have to go back.
Yeah. All right. Well, there it is now. I'll try again the next one. We've got to work this out. They have one generation a year, root weevils do. And They kind of enter the soil in late, mid to late summer as larvae, spend the winter that way, are larger larvae in the spring, and then come out to restart the cycle in the next mid-summer time period. Okay, I'm going to move on next slide and see if I can get my pointer back. A couple points to make in terms of the biology, ecology of this insect that are relevant. The one generation per year is always helpful information. The adults are flightless. They the elytra, that first set of wings, is actually fused on this beetle, so it can't fly. And again, I mentioned this significant, what I call pre-oviposition period, or period before they start, the adults start laying eggs. Okay, well, how do you know if you have a root weevil problem? Well, one is, as I mentioned, the loss of vigor in the plants. That's probably the first thing to notice. I mean, of course, many things can cause loss of vigor. So how do you know if it's root weevil? One way is to dig up crowns of strawberry plants that are looking a little bit weak, and look for the white grubs, the larval stage. In the later summer, they're actually quite small and hard to find. In the spring, they've gotten bigger and they're a little easier to see. So that's one way, and probably a good way to start doing it. Another way that's important is look for activity of the adults. In particular, they have a real characteristic feeding damage involving notching of the leaves on the outside, like shown here and down here. The adults will show this damage, and it's one way to sort of get a first sign that they're showing up. Another way is to actually try to catch the adults in pitfall traps. These are cup-like structures put into the ground at soil level with some sort of solution in there, typically antifreeze or soapy water, and then you cover this whole thing with a shingle, and the adults, which are nocturnal, during the daytime, kind of go in here and hide. They fall into the pit, and you can look for them then. For growers, I think maybe the easiest two things would be to dig up plants to look for grubs and look for this feeding of adults. And the feeding of adults is important because of that pre-oviposition period. Okay, some control tactics then. One is to rotate out of strawberries from a site that has root weevil problems for 1 to 2 years. Why is that helpful? Because the root weevil is flightless, and it's not going to fly over to the next planting. It will walk over to the next planting, however, so it's important to establish a new planting at least 500 meters away from the old planting. And in fact, some people have even tried putting physical barriers between an infested planting that you're leaving or abandoning and a new planting, and catching the beetles and preventing them from gaining access. And I think that's had some success in Canada. I have not tried it myself to see how well it works. There is biological control for root weevil targeted on the grubs, and this involves entomopathic nematodes that infect the larval stage, reproduce inside them, and then release thousands and thousands of infective juvenile nematodes that can then infect other larvae. These nematodes are commercially available, and there's a couple species we note in our guidelines that seem to be particularly effective against root weevils. There's two time periods to try to release these things. One is in the later summer, early fall, where you're going after those immature, the younger stage of the immature root weevil, and trying to kill them off. The nematodes can do that in the fall, and they should overwinter and then be effective again in the spring. Or you can try releasing the nematodes in the spring. Now, I haven't done much with nematodes. An entomologist at the University of Connecticut Field Station, Agricultural Station, has had some success with these nematodes. His name is Rich Cowles, and I think it's worth trying for some of our growers. Now, for a while, we actually had no good chemical controls for adults, and so nematodes was really our only approach, and or rotating out of the strawberry planting. We do now have a couple of materials that are labeled for control, and that they're targeted against the pre-ovipositional period that I talked about in that midsummer period. Again, it's important to know when the adults are first coming out, maybe waiting a week or 10 days, and then applying the insecticide to try to kill those adults before they lay eggs. Okay, that leads us to our next poll question.
All right, if everybody could try to answer that question to the best of their ability, we're going to see how well you were listening. And this is just a way to kind of test the interactivity and try to keep people on board. And I appreciate that. That's wonderful. Everybody voted.
I had the answer. I had the answer right on the slide, but that's okay.
Sorry, that may have been me. Okay.
But I think that's useful knowledge. Thank you. So let's move on to a third pest that's really creating some problems for strawberry growers. This here is a picture of the adult. On the left, it's a brown beetle in the family Nidididae. It's actually quite small. In the middle, you get a sense of the scale. This is an adult on the head of a dime, and it's not much bigger than the nose of, I'm not sure who this person is on the dime. Civics. And on the right is the larval stage of this beetle. Both the adult and the larval stage feed on the fruit, and particularly the larval stage is problematic because of, especially in new pick situations, because people picking fruit don't see the larvae, they're kind of hidden, and they bring them home, they make jams and jellies out of it, and see these little white grubs floating to the top, and that creates all sorts of problems that growers have to try to explain to their customers about. This is the strawberry sap beetle. It is overwintering as the adult stage, again, in hedgerows, along wood edges, this kind of thing. The adults get active early in the season as temperatures warm up. They begin to feed and probably mate, and they may do a little bit of egg laying in the woods or along the edges of woods, but where it becomes a problem for our strawberry growers is that the adults move into the strawberry patch and begin significant feeding and reproducing, which gets a lot of the larvae going that can contaminate the fruit. Strawberry sap beetle will get one generation on strawberries or potentially any other fruit that flowers that early, and then they pupate in the soil, emerge in midsummer, and then do a second generation on other types of fruit, then going on to their overwintering stage again at the end of the season. Okay? Why is this problem, sap beetle, such a problem? It's because of some of their biology that makes it really difficult to treat them. The first thing is they don't overwinter in the strawberries. They overwinter typically in the wood edges, and they only move into the strawberry patch as the fruit's ripening. Just the time that growers want to open up their fields for picking, they've got this pest moving in there that they may need to spray for if that'll work, but it's really not a very convenient time to do that. So it's really tricky that way. Related to that is actually, and I'll mention this later, is the beetle is very secretive. It likes to hide underneath the fruit or in the straw of strawberry, and it's actually hard to get at with an insecticide. Another part of their biology that I think is important is that they, in that second generation, will feed on the residue and coal piles from a lot of other fruit crops, including the cherry, blueberry, raspberry, melons, and probably some other fruits as well that we haven't studied. And though they're not particularly a pest on these other fruit because they typically stay on the ground to feed on the fruit, so it's just fruit that's fallen down to the ground and not really of use to the grower, they can build up large populations on this residue fruit to overwinter, then come in the next year, higher populations can infest the strawberry field. Okay, so that means one approach to controlling this pest is good sanitation in the strawberry field as well as on the residue for the residue of these other crops. Now, I bring this up in a lot of grower meetings I have, talking to strawberry growers who are really frustrated with this pest. I mean, those growers that have it are at wit's end because it is a really difficult one, a really challenging pest to control. And I mentioned, well, sanitation is probably your best approach. And I think they rightfully say, look, it's really impossible to do a clean sanitation of strawberry fields, especially U-pick operations. You can't know exactly how many customers are come. You can't keep them from standing on the fruit and creating all sorts of damaged berries that these beetles like. So it's really tricky. And I appreciate that. All you can say is they do the best they can. I think they can do a little bit better job maybe on the residue from some of these other fruit crops, especially those growers, and a lot of our growers do this, that have multiple fruit on their farms. So something like peaches, if a lot of peaches are falling on the ground, collecting those up periodically and burying them might be a useful thing. I worked with one grower who used to collect his old peaches and melons and just pile them in a big coal pile. Exposed, and he had, you know, sure thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of sap beetles using those residue fruit for reproduction at the end of the season. So I think that's something that can be done that might help the problem. And this is particularly true as our farmers are diversifying and growing so many different crops, some of which can be fed on by this pest. So that's probably my best strategy, but there is also some chemical control options available. It's tricky, as I mentioned, though, because of the secretive nature of these beetles, and also that you have to wait till the fruit is ripening in the field before the beetles are even present. There's two pyrethroid insecticides labeled. Notice that Brigade has a 0 days to harvest, whereas Danitol has 2 days to harvest. So I think for a lot of growers, that 0 days to harvest is a more useful number for them. They can get in there, spray, and then be picking that afternoon, at least 12 hours afterwards. Okay, so that's the last of the strawberry pests I want to talk about. I think we might have another poll question for you here.
All right, great, thank you.
What are we doing on time here?
We are pushing it, but I think we're all right.
All right, we're going to move into blueberries now. I only have two pests I really want to talk about in blueberries. Blueberries is not as large a commodity in New York as strawberries, and because of that, we, in the research side of things and even the extension side, we don't have as much information or tools developed for the pest in blueberries. Nonetheless, there's a couple key pests that we deal with in New York that it's worth going over. First one, it's actually two species, but they have very similar biology, so I've combined them. The adult shown here on the left, and then the damage and the larva of one of the species shown here in the middle on blueberries, and then the second species, the larval stage, and the damage from the second species shown on the right. These are all fruit worms. The one on the left is the cranberry fruit worm, and the one larva on the right, I don't have a picture of the adult, is the cherry fruit worm. Again, little close-ups of the damage. This is kind of diagnostic of the two species. The cranberry fruit worm tends to feed on several berries. It's kind of a messy feeder. It creates a lot of frass and webbing and stuff, whereas the cherry fruit worm tends to stay within a single berry and not show such significant symptoms. Okay, here's our life cycle. It's pretty similar for both species. They overwinter as late instar larvae and then pupate in the spring and come out at around bloom time for blueberries. And the adult flight is over about a 3-week period. Timing depends on temperature and things like that. And they have one generation per year causing the damage I just showed you. Okay, review of the biology details that are helpful. They overwinter as larvae, late instar larvae. Adult flight starts at around end of bloom time, one generation per year, and then some differences between cranberry fruit worm and cherry fruit worm, which I discussed previously. All right, so how do we, how does a grower know they've got problems? What scouting protocols do we have available? For the fruit worms, we have pheromone traps to monitor the timing of adult flight. This can provide some important information on when growers might consider applying some sort of control measure. It can give you a little information whether you have fruit worm or don't have fruit worm, but its best use is for timing. The pheromone trap is shown here in the picture here that Molly Shaw loaned me. And what it is, it's baited with a sex pheromone for the specific fruit worm species. So there's a pheromone for cranberry fruit worm and a pheromone for cherry fruit worm. The males are attracted to the pheromone and they get stuck on the sticky material in the trap. So that's probably our best and most effective way for monitoring for the presence of these fruit worm pests. And I want to mention that our most common species in our area is the cranberry fruit worm, CFW in this slide. The cherry fruit worm is not as common. Each one has a pheromone, and you need to use the pheromones in separate traps. But our focus, typically in New York, has been on the cranberry fruit worm. You can also look for eggs in the very young fruit after a fruit set's occurred. It takes some training. Here I show a picture of the two different species of egg, and after a while you can figure out how to do it, but I don't think it's a very helpful tool for most growers without some very specific training. I know Molly Shaw, when she did her study last year, she did take time to show growers how to do this, and I think she was able to train some to do it. So, cranberry fruit worm is one of our two significant pests in blueberries. It's a big pest in some other blueberry growing areas, Michigan, New Jersey, and therefore there are actually quite a few pesticides labeled for their use, and I've listed them in this table. The factors that I think that growers need to keep in mind, though, and I'm sure they do because they know how important pollination is in blueberries, is whether the materials they're using are safe for bees or not. Most of the compounds, especially the broad spectrum compounds listed here, are not safe for bees. That's why you need to wait till after petal fall to put an application on. A few of them, like the BT, Bacillus thuringiensis, and the Spintor spinosad product, Spintor and Trust, are pretty safe for bees. So if you have some reason to think that oviposition is starting in parts of your planting while flowering is still going on, you could use those materials. Okay. Laura, I think I'm at the end of the fruit worm discussion, so I don't know if we had a question for fruit worms as well.
I have one question, Greg.
Good.
Under the column for bee safe, where it says Spintor, it says that Spintor is not bee safe. Is that correct?
Oops. Yeah, thank you, Laura. You know, it's one of these things that's right. Thank you for the clarification. It is not safe until it dries. That's why I have a no there. So you can, if you time it right, spray at night, you can use it, but it is not safe when it's wet.
Okay, great.
Thanks.
I can open up this poll if you'd like me to.
Okay, please.
Folks wouldn't mind just reading that and voting. Might be trickier to remember.
Okay, let's move on to the second key blueberry pest. On the left here is a picture of the adult fly. I think she's about to oviposit egg. That egg hatches into a larva that feeds on the interior of the blueberry and eventually drops out of that blueberry to go to the ground. This, of course, is the blueberry maggot fly. a pretty significant pest, particularly in states that do a lot of blueberries for retail, where the tolerance for blueberry maggot is basically zero. In New York, where we have a lot of U-pick systems, we actually can tolerate some blueberry maggot because the damaged berries often drop off, or the people that are picking the fruit throw them away, or aren't so concerned about a few kind of dinged up berries. They kind of expect that. It's the retail people that really have a problem with this. Nonetheless, the blueberry maggot can be abundant enough in New York to warrant some sort of control. All right, here's the life cycle of blueberry maggot. Again, just one generation a year for this guy. It overwinters, as I mentioned, in the soil, and really doesn't start coming out of the pupal stage until mid-late summer, when you start seeing some ripening in blueberries. The adults actually have, again, one of these pre-oviposition periods where for about 10 days they have to feed. Then they start mating and laying eggs. This is a fairly protracted emergence of adults from the soil, so that once you start getting adults out, even though an individual adult might only live for, you know, a couple weeks, you keep getting new adults coming out from the soil, so that you have blueberries out, the blueberry maggot flies out for most of the summer. I'm going to figure out this green pointer, but I haven't yet. All right, so that's your life cycle. Again, the review, one generation per season. They overwinter as pupae in the soil below the plants. They have this prolonged emergence from June to August. They have a significant pre-ovipositional period. And as you'd guess, that's an important factor for control. They usually lay one egg per berry. And they often are common in wild or abandoned blueberries. That makes sense. And having a wild patch of blueberries near a commercial operation increases the risk from blueberry maggot. Right, monitoring for blueberry maggot is important, and we have some well-developed tools for doing this. The use of a yellow sticky card, you've probably all dealt with this in one circumstance or another. It's a yellow card coated with a sticky material, is pretty attractive to the adult maggot fly. And in addition, you can add feeding stimulants to the card that makes it even more attractive, so that the flies, especially in this pre-ovipositional period where they're hungry and looking for protein food, are attracted to the card with the attractant. The attractant being protein hydroxylate and ammonium acetate. Okay. And Molly Shaw loaned me some pictures again showing these traps. It's a close-up of a trap that she brought in from the field. Note that the traps, I'm sure you've experienced, collect all sorts of flies and other kinds of insects, so you have to be pretty good at being able to identify the blueberry maggot, which has that very characteristic markings on the wing. The way to think of these traps is that they're an early warning system for determining when you need to start worrying about control of blueberry maggots. If you've got a problem with blueberry maggots, or a grower has a problem with blueberry maggots, knowing when that start of the emergence is important. Basically, our prescription then is you need to start spraying an insecticide like malathione, and continue to spray really for the remainder of the summer, you know, every 7 to 10 days. Because of that prolonged emergence of the blueberry maggot from the soil, once you get some, you will continually see them through the rest of the summer. Again, there's several products labeled for blueberry maggot. These are listed here. I don't have anything particular to mention here, except to again point out that what you're trying to do with this spray is to get it on before you get egg laying. And so once again, it's important, just like with those root weevils, to determine when the start of the flight is in order to better time your sprays. Okay, Laura, I think that's it for blueberries. Do we have a question for
that? Yes, we do.
Oh, wait, I can't ask this question yet.
Oh, okay, I won't open it.
All right.
I won't open it.
All right. Well, I didn't mention something. I'll go ahead and open it up, Laura. Sorry. But I mentioned that blueberries are, wild blueberries are an important source for blueberry maggot. And I also mentioned it's important to get an early warning system for the emergence of blueberry maggots. What we find is that in the commercial blueberry patch, there's a delay in when the blueberry maggots make it there. So they're probably emerging from the wild populations of blueberries, and it takes them a few days to make it over to the cultivated blueberries. So there is, if you have the opportunity, a grower, it's helpful to put a trap near a wild planting of blueberries so that you can identify the immediate start of the emergence of the blueberries instead of losing a couple days information so that you might be starting to put your insecticide on too late.
All right.
There you go.
Thank you. All right.
I want to talk about raspberries now to finish this up. I'm going to talk about a couple pests in raspberries that, I mean, there's a bunch of insects that feed on raspberries, and it's hard to pick which ones are more important than others, but I focused in on two. One's kind of a fruit pest, leaf pest, and the other one's an important cane and root pest. Okay, the first one is this beetle shown on the left. It is called the raspberry fruit worm. So it's got that fruit worm name again, but it's actually a beetle. It feeds on the flower buds of raspberries and on the leaves shown in the middle picture here, causing this kind of stripped look to the leaves. It lays its eggs near a flower bud or opening flower. The eggs hatch, and the larvae get inside and feed on the bud flower or bud and fruit, and often start emerging for pupation about the time harvest occurs. Again, this is for the summer fruiting raspberries. Now, there's a second pest, one I'm not going to focus in on because the chemical control for raspberry fruit worm is the same as for the sawfly, but I wanted to point it out because it actually causes damage pretty similar on the leaf. This is raspberry sawfly. If you go into raspberry fields, you almost always see some of this leaf feeding damage shown on the left, where they fed and made holes in the interior part of the leaf. The raspberry fruit worm causes similar damage, although they tend to strip the leaf out to the margins of the leaf, whereas sawfly tends to be more in the interior of the leaf. But it's pretty similar looking. It can be confused. The immature stage of the sawfly is shown on the right. It's this green worm-like thing that's got these kind of whitish hairs on it. Fairly easy to find if you see the damage. The raspberry sawfly, it can get bad enough to cause economic damage, but often it's just cosmetic problems. However, the chemical control, if you have to deal with raspberry fruit worm, is the same, and the timing's the same for raspberry sawfly. Let's focus on this raspberry fruit worm. There's actually two species, one on the West Coast called the western raspberry fruit worm, and then our species on the east. It overwinters in the soil as a pupa. As I mentioned, it gets active in the spring. And the adults come out and they feed on those flower buds and maybe flowers, begin laying eggs, and you get that larva. One generation during the year. These can be abundant, and because they attack the fruit in addition to the leaves, they can be a serious pest. In addition, the larvae start coming out about the time you're harvesting, and you don't really want to get those larvae dropping out in the basket of raspberries. So it's considered one of our more important pests. Now, I shouldn't admit this, but I don't work a lot in raspberries, but I've never actually seen this pest in raspberries. I have a planting here on the station. I haven't found it there. I haven't been to a field that has it, but I certainly know, talking to growers, that some areas have problems with this pest. Okay, so one generation a year can be a problem in some areas. What do we have in terms of controlling it? Well, one of the most effective, of course, is using fall maturing raspberries that are able to kind of escape this pest. It's coming out in the spring. There's no fruit buds out available on fall bearing raspberries, so that there's really no concern for it at all. In terms of chemical control, I guess the two points I wanted to make is one, that the timing for this should be before bloom. The compounds we have can be or are harmful to pollinators, so you want to use it pre-bloom time period. This is also the time when you can kill the adults before they've had a chance to lay a lot of eggs. That's the eastern raspberry fruit worm, a pest, as I admit, I haven't really seen around New York, but can be a problem. All right, before I go into my next couple of pests, do we have a poll question?
We do. To have everybody voting. Thank you. That's great.
Okay. Now I'm going to finish up with a couple of important pests in raspberries that attack the canes and roots. The first one shown here, it's a beetle. It is actually kind of a handsome beetle, I think, shown over here. The females lay their eggs. The adults don't really do much damage, but the females lay their eggs in a actively growing stem of a sort of primocane type raspberry. The egg hatches and the larvae burrow into the stem, into the pith. In the process of laying the eggs, the females girdle the stem and it causes the stem to kind of wilt over like this. The larvae, as I said, burrow into the pith, heading downward into the cane and eventually reaching the crown area. This is called the raspberry cane borer. There's a second species of cane borer-like species I'm not going to mention today. I'm just focusing on this raspberry cane borer, which we often see in New York plantings of raspberry, particularly this damage to the shoot tips during the season. I often will find some of this in a lot of plantings I go to. This is a pretty serious pest if you get an abundance of them and they get down into the crown. The second cane and root pest I want to mention is this insect shown here. Now on the left, you might look at this and say, oh, that's weird, it looks like a wasp. This is the adult stage, and in fact, it is a moth. It's called the raspberry crown borer. It's a mimic of a wasp that's used as a defense to keep it from being eaten by birds, but it actually lays an egg and gets a larva out of it. The egg is shown here. That little brown guy lays on raspberry leaves and weed species around the base of a raspberry plant. The egg hatches. It gets along the bottom part of the cane, hatching and burrowing into the cane and down into the crown, so you get these huge larvae in there by the second year that get to be over like an inch and a half long in size. Because of this feeding into the crown, they cause a collapse of that cane and maybe several canes that might be coming near that crown and killing it. So this is a pretty serious problem if this happens, where you're basically knocking out that whole system for fruit production. Okay, here's the life cycle of the cane borer. Okay, so it's a little confusing. I first introduced the raspberry cane borer, showed you what the symptoms look like. Then I showed you the raspberry crown borer, that moth that mimics a wasp. Okay, so those are the two pests I want to talk about. So now I'm going to jump back to the raspberry cane borer and just talk more about its biology and management. And I'll finish up then with the raspberry crown borer. So cane borer first, then crown borer. Sorry for the confusion. They should rename these things. But I've combined them because they're both kind of pests of canes and crowns of the plant. Okay, raspberry cane borer. The adult comes out in early summer, late spring. It's around for a long time period, actually, in which it mates and lays eggs that cause that characteristic shoot wilting that I showed you. The eggs hatch and they burrow into the cane, and they probably spend that first year in the cane. They overwinter that way, and then they have a second year in the cane where they go further down towards the roots or crown. They spend a second winter in that position. And then in the spring of their third year, actually, they pupate and start the cycle over again. So it's got 2 years that it spends in the cane as an immature stage. So it spends most of its life as an immature and a relatively short time as an adult, a couple months during the summer. Okay, so the problem with raspberry cane borer is once it gets down into the cane, it's pretty hard to control. We don't really, actually we have no insecticides even labeled for its use in New York. So our primary way to deal with this pest is to focus in on the symptoms of damage during the season and try to get rid of them before they have a chance to get very far down into the cane. So it's a kind of a cultural control that goes along with monitoring for this very characteristic damage. So I just want to point this out again, if I can. This is the girdling that the female does above and below the egg scar. The egg is in here. Why they do this, I don't really know. But they may affect the movement of phloem in the shoot or something that's beneficial to the larva. I'm just not sure. But because of this girdling, you get this tipping over of the shoot fairly quickly after the oviposition event. So one important way and good way to try to control this pest is to go around and monitor for this damage and cut it out of the planting below this second girdle line, somewhere down here, and destroying these girdled shoot tips, thereby destroying the larva and preventing it from successfully gaining access to a larger part of that cane. This is somewhat labor-intensive procedure, and one that I think growers will tend to ignore early in the infestation. And then by the time it's gotten to be really bad, they're noticing that whole canes are dying, they're having problems in the planting. It's almost impossible to deal with it. And I've certainly had growers that have had to kind of abandon plantings because of this raspberry cane borer. So, management of raspberry cane borer. It's focused all on cultural. During the season, monitoring and removing these girdled shoot tips a few inches below that bottom girdle line is, I think, the smartest thing and most effective thing to do. Or in the winter, identifying these canes that have died on you and pulling them out during the dormant season and destroying them, and you'll get the larvae that way. Probably both those approaches is important, especially if the planting is in an area where there's a lot of wild brambles and therefore a bigger population of this pest. A grower could try removing wild brambles near their planting. I don't know if this works or not. There is anecdotal observations that suggest it might be helpful. As I said, in New York, there are no chemicals labeled to control this pest. I guess if one had a chemical, it would probably have to target the adult during that early and midsummer period. Okay, quiz time.
Excellent. You guys are really paying attention. Thank you.
That question was kind of ambiguous, so you did well. Okay, so that's the raspberry cane borer. Let's pretty quickly go over the raspberry crown borer. In some ways, maybe even a more significant pest. It can be quite destructive in raspberries. Again, pictures to remind you, the adult here on the right, it's a moth that mimics a wasp. And then a pretty mature couple of larvae here that are at the base of canes, and you can see how much feeding damage they can do to that. Life cycle of this pest is also fairly complicated. In this case, the adults actually come out later in the season, late July, early August in New York, and they're pretty easy to observe if there's a high population. Obviously, they're very colorful, that yellow and black. They're not particularly skittish as insects go, because they mimic this wasp, and most people don't like to pick up wasps, so they tend to be very visible. So what's one way to monitor for it is to look for the adults. They begin laying eggs on foliage. I think an adult can lay 50 or so eggs. The larvae hatch, and they go to the base of the cane, and they just stay on the outside of the cane, building a structure they call, I think it's called a hyperculum. So they hang out the base of the raspberry cane and then penetrate the cane the following year, and then move down into the crown and roots, where they spend the whole year and the next winter, and then finish up their development during that third year and come out as adults to start the cycle over. So again, a large part of this insect's life, it's spent pretty well hidden inside the canes and crowns of raspberries. As I said, this can be a pretty destructive pest, and here's some examples of some collapsed canes. What we often see in a planting that's got problems is that second and third year, that second year particularly, really puts a lot of stress on the plant. The shoots are up, but just about the time they're trying to set fruit or mature fruit, the cane just collapses on it. So that's a pretty common observation. And if you go down to the base of those canes and you rip up the crown, you often find those big grubs in there. Again, this pest, if it gets abundant, can destroy a planting. What are our management techniques? Well, in this case, we have both cultural and chemical approaches. Cultural, like the raspberry cane borer, is to remove those dying canes and crowns, in this case, during the dormant season, in order to get rid of them. You pull them out and you destroy them. And that's one approach, really one of our main approaches. Again, possibly removing wild brambles can reduce populations. Raspberry crown borer is a host specialist, so it's only feeding on raspberries. So if you can get rid of that reservoir of raspberry, you might be able to help manage pests. We also have chemical control options, and we only got this quite recently. It's only been in the last couple of years that we had an insecticide labeled against raspberry crown borer. And this insecticide is targeted against the young, immature larva before it penetrates the cane or the base of the cane. So remember I told you that larva, the egg hatches, and the larva kind of hangs out at the outside of the cane. So you do a drench spray of this insecticide on the bottom part of the cane around the crown, where you're spraying target this immature either in the fall after it's got established or in the spring before it really has time to penetrate the cane. I have seen some efficacy data suggesting this is a fairly good way to go. Maybe the fall application working a little bit better.
Right. Okay. Can I interrupt? Yep. Did you see the question from Molly Shaw?
No.
It's right there in.
No, I didn't. Molly Shaw, here we go. Molly, I'm going to read this.
Right.
Oh, everybody can see it, right?
Right.
Okay, I'll still read it. So unlike the strawberry crown borer, if there are raspberry crown borers present, there will always be wilted shoots. Well, Molly, I'm not sure if you meant the strawberry crown borer or... I'm not sure what you mean by strawberry crown borer, I guess. There is some strawberry pests that do get into the crown. If that's what you're referring to, I'm not really sure. Okay, the root weevil. Okay. Yeah, you know, maybe that first year of an infestation, you might not see the collapse of these canes. I'm not really sure, to be honest. Now that's with the crown borer. With the raspberry cane borer, you always see that wilted shoot tip above that girdled mark. So with the cane borer, you get that wilted shoot that is a clear diagnostic characteristic, and you always get that. For crown borer, you know, I'm not 100% sure how long that takes before you see that collapsing cane, where the whole cane collapses. You'll also see this collapsing cane with raspberry cane borer after that full year that it's spent in the cane. Does that make sense? So the cane borer, initially you get the wilted shoot tip because of the oviposition and girdling. And then later on, the next year probably, or maybe the end of that year, you'll get a collapsing cane because the larva is now penetrated and burrowed down into the pith. With the crown borer, you won't see much that initial spring when the larva penetrates, but maybe by the end of that season or the next season, you'll start seeing collapsing canes. I hope that answers your question, Molly. Okay. Laura, do we have a last question for him?
We do. This is the last one you guys have to answer. A few people may have stepped away a little bit there, but we'll close that. And I want to thank you guys for trying this particular route out with kind of interactivity.
I've sort of covered what I see as the key pests that you might run into. You know, I know some of the extension educators only occasionally deal with fruit pests, and maybe this talk is best geared to them. Others of you, like Molly, are working in fruit a lot, and so this may be somewhat well-known to Molly and quite a bit of a review. But for those of you who don't work in it a lot, some of these things are going to crop up, and maybe this will give you a good handle on helping to diagnose a problem and pointing a grower in the right direction in terms of dealing with the problem. There are a fair number of resources for you to go to get information. As I mentioned, you can email or phone me with questions, have growers call. I get some of those every year. In addition, there's a lot of resources both printed and in the web. On the back side of that handout, I've listed some of the ones I use. In this last picture I have for you, I just kind of grabbed the beginning of Marvin Pritz's berry diagnostic tool, which many of you are probably familiar with. It's a very useful way to sort of to narrow down the potential problem that you see in a blueberry, raspberry, or a strawberry planting. So I recommend that and some of these other resources. With that, it's about 2:10. I've gone over a little bit. I apologize for that. I don't know where we want to go from here, Laura, but I'm pretty much done now with the formal part of the presentation.
Greg, I want to thank you so much. It was a great effort at making it more interactive, and I really appreciate that. If anybody has any questions for Greg, maybe we might have 30 seconds. And if not, hopefully we will see most of you back again on November 19th. When we have information about small fruit nutrition. So thanks very, very much. There's a few people typing.
Me saying thank you.
Okay, great. Thanks very much. And I will be sending out an evaluation to those of you that were on today. I do want to let you know in advance, I may be asking some fairly pointed questions because we are applying for a grant to do a little bit more webcasting. And I would appreciate any comments that you have that could help us go forward with that. So thank you again, Greg, and thank the rest of you for participating.
Welcome. Have a good rest of the day. Enjoy the sun.
And that concludes this berry webcast.